So today's topic of discussion is anal cancer. It is a very rare cancer. Only 2.7% of all the digestive system malignancies will comprise of the anal cancers. However, we should the medical oncologist should be praised would be proud as it is the first GI malignancy to have a non-surgical treatment. So I will discuss anatomy of the anal canal, pathology, epidemiology and risk factors, staging, treatment of the localized disease, how to follow up and how to treat a metastatic or locally or advanced disease. So anal canal, it's from the anal verge to the above the transitional zone is the anal canal. Below the anal anal verge is the anal margin. The cancer of the anal margin is also treated as the same way as that of the anal canal. Lymphatic drainage because of the RT put is important here. Immediately above the dentate line, the drainage is to the internal pudendal nodes and to the internal iliac nodes. And while those in the infradentate and the perianal skin region is to the inguinal, femoral and the external iliac nodes. The lymphatic drainage is not limited to the distal or proximal and there is rich network of connection between the two. Pathological classification of the types of cancer that can be found. Previously there used to be multiple types, but now grossly there are three types only: squamous cell adenocarcinoma and the anal margin, which is also called as perianal skin cancers. Mostly it is squamous cell carcinoma and it is treated similar to the anal canal cancers. The most common type is squamous cell carcinoma, and tumor arising in the transitional or in the upper transitional part or in the squamous mucosa is mainly of the squamous cell carcinoma. It comprises of the 85 to 90% of all the anal canal cancers. Above the dental line, it is often non-keratinizing, and below the dentate line up to the pectin is often keratinizing variant of the squamous cell carcinoma. Rarely, we can even find adenocarcinoma where granular elements can be seen, and it has similar natural history to that of the rectal adenocarcinomas. Epidemiology, it is uncommon cancer, but however, the incidence is increasing in past decade, along with the increase in the nodal disease burden at presentation. Much more are metastatic at presentation compared to those in a decade ago, and increases the corresponding mortality too. In contrast to other common malignancy affecting HIV positive individuals, the incidence of anal cancer has not declined even after the use of potent ARTs, and median age of diagnosis is around 60 to 65 years. Risk factors for anal cancer is more common in females compared to males, more common in HIV infected patients, or any other immunosuppressive disease or conditions like chronic post-transplant status, HPV infections, genital warts, lifetime number of sexual partners, more common in smokers, and receptive persons who have receptive anal intercourse. A brief word about HPV. HPV DNA has been isolated in around 46 to 100% of in situ lesions and in invasive cancers. Up to 93% of anal squamous cell carcinoma are associated with HPV infection. Women are more likely to have HPV associated anal cancer compared to men. However, HPV 16 presence is associated with a better prognosis. HPV associated tumors are more chemo responsive because they retain P53 wild type. And the spectrum of HPV types in the anal cancer canal is similar to those described in cervix and is associated with the same risk phenotypes, that is HPV 16 and 18. No difference between HPV positive and HPV negative tumors in regards to patient age, the presence of adjacent dysplasia, ductal difference, differentiation or prognosis. So HPV leads to low grade changes and then into a invasive carcinoma. So we are how are these precancerous lesions of the anal cancer? According to European classification, it is like anal intraepithelial, it is classified as anal intraepithelial neoplasm grade 1 to 3, where grade 1 is where cellular and nuclear abnormalities are confined to the lower one third of the epithelium, grade 2 when it is confined to the lower two third of the epithelium, and grade 3 when whole of the epithelium are showing changes, precancerous changes. While the Americans classify precancerous lesions into a typical squamous cell of undetermined significance. Later on, low grade intraepithelial neoplasm, which is called L-cell, or a high grade intraepithelial neoplasm. Because anal cancers are so rare, that the screening, there are no defined screening criteria. Otherwise, you see the histories, the course, their course is almost similar to cervical neoplasm. And if there is benefit of screening in cervical neoplasm, there can be benefit of screening this. Those at high risk patients, as previously alluded to, those who have the risk factors, they can be screened for anal cancers, for all this precancerous lesions, and prevent cancer from happening in them. How do this patients present? So because of the common presentation of bleeding from the anal region and anal discomfort, most of them either ignore themselves, or even if they go to a local physician, they also initially misdiagnose at a hemorrhoid or other some local pathology. In multiple retrospective series, the time of presentation to doctor from the beginning of symptoms was around 3.5 months, and the time to diagnosis was also 7 months, because even after presenting to the physician, because of the generalized symptoms like those of hemorrhoids, it was commonly misdiagnosed initially. There was one series where even time to diagnosis from symptoms were 2 years. Most of them is non-specific, like bleeding and anal discomfort in almost half of the patient. Other symptoms can be awareness of an anal mass protruding outside. There can be pruritus, anal discharge, pain, alteration in bowel habits, asymptomatic tumors like which can present with just an inguinal nodal mass. Unsuspected microinvasive carcinoma is sometimes found in mucosa, which is removed for hemorrhoidectomy. How do we supposedly we have got a patient who we know by has anal cancer, invasive cancer. So first we will need a biopsy to confirm the diagnosis. What are the mandatory one for is a confirmed diagnosis? Full medical history, including some immunocompromised status, full body clinical examination, including the inguinal nodes, digital rectal examination, blood test, including renal function test, proctoscopy, a pelvic MRI, CT thorax and abdomen. Pelvic MRI, because it helps in local disease status. CT thorax and abdomen for distant disease status, as we saw that it is rich in lymphatic spread, so even direct lung spread can happen, and the para-aortic node or liver mets are very common. Assessment of genital tract in females for cervical intraepithelial neoplasm optional but are recommended are HIV test, needle aspiration of the groin nodes, examination under NS, complete examination under anesthesia, and if possible, see a PET CT scan. A PET CT scan can upgrade nodal disease in 4-5% of the patients, and can upgrade nodal disease in 20% of the patient, and change management in 4-5% of the patients. Optional are colonoscopy. There was, again, because of rare disease, some guidelines say that up to 15% of the patient may have concomitant GI tract, but other guidelines that I found said there is no role of colonoscopy, as there is no concomitant GI tract malignancies in this patient. So I think it is confusion and we don't do colonoscopy. Endo-anal and ultrasound can be done if pelvic MRI is not available. And assessment of by a geriatrician, because of most of this patient will have age of more than 60 years, as we saw in the epidemiology section. How do we stage anal cancers? So T1 is those tumor which are less than 2 cm, T2 is up to 5 cm, T3 is more than 5 cm, and T4 when it is invading into adjacent organs. Nodal disease is now only N1, that is mets into regional lymph nodes, and if it is distant met, it is M1. Okay. Staging up as per AJCC 8th edition is on the right hand side of the screen. What are the predictors of outcome? So local regional failure is predicted when tumors are more than 4 cm or they have an ulcerative lesion, when they are nodal positive, when there is break in the RT, or complete RT could not be given, or there is early T response, then they are good predictors. Survival, how do we predict survival, will be based on the more than 4 cm, they are node positive, or there is delayed response in the initial tumor. Now let's come, how do we treat a localized anal cancer? Historically, treatment for anal cancer was APR. You can see in publication, a retrospective publication in 1989 showed that 5-year OS of anal margin cancer was around 55% in 72 cases, and it was around 58% in 123 cases of anal cancer. Okay, so But presently, a surgery role has diminished. I will come to it in the next subsequent slides. And it is presently used only in selected cases where local option excision can be done in those patients with tumor, T1 tumor. If I want to be more specific, I will say in those where it can be locally excised with less than 3 millimeters of basement membrane invasion and a maximum horizontal spread of less than 7 millimeters without LVI. Otherwise, it is reserved for patient with recurrent or persistent disease even after chemo radiation. Now, how did treatment evolve? Simultaneously, there was publications of patients who were not willing for surgery or were not able to undergo surgery. They received radiotherapy. So a simultaneous publication in 1985 showed that again the 5-year OS were around 67% of those patients who are only undergoing radiotherapy, while 75% of this patient even retained their renal function till the date of analysis of this publication. Again, a retrospective publication. So you can see two publications, role of surgery, 5-year OS around 55 to 58%, and role of radiotherapy, again 5-year OS was around 67% with the added benefit of retained renal function. Because of your APR, the colostomy was done in all the patients who underwent surgery. So based on this publications and multiple experiences, there was no randomized trial comparing surgery versus radiotherapy, but because of the good functional outcome and almost similar OS, the radiotherapy became standard of care. Then came the era of combined radiotherapy with chemotherapy. So Mr. Negro et al. Began in 1974, where a colleague's mother was diagnosed with anal cancer, and they knew that only surgery will lead to poor outcome. So they wanted to add something else to their pre-surgery treatment. So they did CTRT by continuous 5-FU infusion and mitomycin C. And in other patients who were planned for surgery, but initially locally advanced, so surgery would have been too morbid. What they were astonished to see was all three patients achieved achieved complete response. Two had PAT CR on surgery later on, and one had clinical CR and refused to undergo surgery even at later date. So the further trials were done to see whether radiotherapy is standard of care or adding chemotherapy has some benefit. So first randomized trial would be the UKCC CCCR anal cancer trial, that which is also called ACT1, where patients were randomized into RT alone arm or chemo radiotherapy arm, as the regime was almost the same as used by Ms. Negro et al. Group, and a boost was given those who had residual disease for say 25 gray implant or a 15 gray in 6 fractions. What did they found out was that in the RT alone arm, the relapse, local regional relapse, were more compared to the combined chemo radiotherapy arm. I'm saying about local relapse. The colostomy free survival, you can see at 5 years, 10 years and 12 years also, around 10% difference between those who had received combined therapy were colostomy free compared to those who received RT alone. However, overall survival was not much significant. Statistically significant, but around 5% benefit is there in even after 12 years follow up. At 15 years follow up, the overall survival in RT alone arm was 5.4 years compared to 7.6 years in the combined chemo and radiation arm. Second trial of 110 patients. This initial trial included all patients, even with T1, T2 lesions. Here, second trial by EORTCT group included only patients with T3, T4 lesions or a nodal disease, were randomized again to RT alone arm or concomitant RT with chemotherapy arm. Again, they also found a similar finding as per the previous ACT1, that the CTRT arm had significantly increased higher PAT CR rate. It increased from 54% to 80% with addition of chemotherapy to radiotherapy, and higher 5-year loco-regional control rate and 32% higher colostomy free rate. However, there was no overall survival difference between the two groups because they could be salvaged by surgery, and hence survival difference is not there between radiotherapy versus chemoradiotherapy. But there was a concern. Everybody thought that mitomycin is too toxic. Around 23% of the patient will have hematological toxicities. That is 1/4 of your patients will have. So a trial was planned whether we can we omit mitomycin. A joint trial by RTOG and ECOG. Here they randomized 310 patients to CTRT with 5-FU and or with mitomycin, plus or minus mitomycin. So 5-FU was given to all patients. Patient who received mitomycin had significantly better 4-year colostomy-free survival. You can see by 12%. Again, disease-free survival was better around 22%. However, PET-CR and OS were similar. We found that OS, there was no difference in OS, whether even if we omitted 5-FU. So similarly, here there was OS was not different, but grade 4 toxicities were more in the mitomycin arm and fatal neutropenic sepsis was more common in the mitomycin arm. But because of the higher colostomy-free survival and disease-free survival, mitomycin remains standard of care. Now, if mitomycin is to be, second drug has to be added to 5-FU. Can we replace mitomycin by something else? So there is ACT2 trial, which was 2x2 factorial design. It answered two questions, whether mitomycin can be replaced by cisplatin. And you can see patients were randomized, around 470 patients were randomized in both the arm. Another part of this trial was whether there is role of giving maintenance or adjuvant chemotherapy after CTRT. Here again, you can see this same patients were randomized even to these two arms, maintenance versus no maintenance after radiotherapy. Chemo radiotherapy. And what did we see? That acute toxicities were almost the same in both the arms of mitomycin or cisplatin, whether we gave mitomycin or cisplatin with 5-FU. CR rate continued to increase, and the CR at 26 weeks, that is approximately 6 months, was the primary endpoint. And you can see the CR rate was almost the same in both the arms. So you can either use 5-FU with mitomycin or cisplatin, the response rate would be same. One point that they saw that the CR rate continued to increase up to 6 months. So now almost before saying that the patient has not responded to radiotherapy, either patient should progress after completing chemoradiotherapy, or you should wait for 6 months to say whether patient has responded or not responded. They can continue to respond from 11 weeks to 26 weeks. What they found out, the PFS was almost sitting on one above the other, 73% versus 74%, whether it was MMC or cisplatin. And those who did not achieve CR did worse compared to those who achieved CR. Whether there is role of maintenance, you can see those who received maintenance or those who did not receive maintenance the progression-free survival was almost the same at 75% for both of them. And overall survival was also almost the same, 84% versus 85%. So this trial said two things, that you can replace mitomycin with cisplatin, but toxicities may reduce, and the maintenance, there is no rule of adjuvant maintenance, but still because of the ease of mitomycin remains the standard of care even now. We saw that there was no role of adjuvant chemotherapy. So can a new adjuvant chemotherapy before CTRT play a role? So this was answered by this intergroup RTOG 9811 trial, where patients with T2 to T4, N0 or N1 were randomized to chemoradiotherapy alone or induction chemotherapy with 5-FU cisplatin for 2 cycles, followed by chemoradiotherapy with cisplatin. Again, this trial also gave answer of mitomycin versus cisplatin also. Here, 682 patients in all the trials, non-HIV infected patients were taken for all the trials of anal cancer. The primary endpoint of this trial was 5 years DFS, and it was more with mitomycin, that is 67.8% compared to the cisplatin arm. So either the inferior survival is because of giving NACT before or because of cisplatin, answer could not be given. But we saw from previous trial that replacing cisplatin is not inferior. So maybe induction chemotherapy did a difference of decreasing the DFS from 67% to 58%. Maybe it is only extrapolation from previous trial. Overall survival also was less in the cisplatin arm at 5 years, from 78% to decreased to 71%. And colostomy-free survival also was inferior in this cisplatin or induction chemotherapy arm. It was 72% in mitomycin arm versus 65% in the cisplatin arm. So is it end of the induction chemotherapy? Whether it was detrimental, there is no answer. But a retrospective analysis in 2011 showed that induction chemotherapy before CTRT may be beneficial for a subset of patients, especially with those who have T4 disease. And here, the 5-year colostomy free survival was significantly better in patients with T4 disease who received induction chemotherapy, which was 100% compared to only 38% who did not receive induction chemotherapy. So this is just hypothesis generating that maybe induction chemotherapy still has role in T4 disease. Now, can we replace 5-FU with capecitabine and continue with mitomycin? So there are in small trials of small phase 2 trials of around 30 patients or 50 patients in each arm, and they showed that replacing 5-FU with capecitabine is almost the same. Another we presented in ESMO last year, which is one of the largest data of capecitabine mitomycin, where we where the response evaluation was available for around 90 patients, and one-fourth have residual or progressive disease, while 73% responded. Only 4% required salvage surgery, and the 2-year relapse-free survival was 82%, while 2-year OS was 85%. The common grade 3-4 toxicities are around 21% local skin reaction, neutropenia, and thrombocytopenia. What do we do for patients who have locally recurrent or persistent disease? So again, APR still remains the treatment of choice. Long-term disease control is achieved in only 25 to 40% of these patients who did not do well with chemoradiotherapy. And sphincter-sparing salvage therapy are difficult tasks in this population, where those who have already received CTRT. RTOG or ECOG, in the previous RTOG ECOG trial that we saw before, there from that subgroup of 22 patients with persistent disease, they were treated with 5-FU cisplatin and RT, 9-gray boost, as a salvage regime. 55%, half of them were rendered disease free, but only 1/3 remained. Out of this 50%, only 1/3 remained disease free. So it is a difficult task if we think about sparing surgery in this subset who do not do well with initial chemoradiotherapy. So surgery still remains the treatment of choice. Post-treatment, those who have completed CTRT, how do we treat them? How do we follow up them? So squamous cell carcinoma regressed slowly and continues to decrease in size up to 26 weeks, as we saw in the previous prospective trials. Clinical assessment by physical examination like DRE, palpation of the inguinal node is to be done every 2 to 3 monthly. Patients with complete clinical response, re-evaluation is done every 3 or 6 monthly by a DRE, endoscopy, and inguinal node palpations for up to 5 years period. A contrast enhanced CT scan of chest and abdomen and pelvis, or a contrast enhanced MRI of the pelvis, can be performed semi-annually or annually for up to 3 years at least, because local recurrences are common up to 3 years, and after 3 years local recurrences are not very common, so a need of a local MRI of pelvis is not required after 3 years. Toxicity and complication, where the survival increase, next point that comes to us, can we reduce toxicities or at least see how do we follow up this long-term patients? So radiation-induced late complication usually appear around 6 to 12 months after treatment and affect around 5 to 11% of the patients. Typical manifestations are because of this progressive fibrosis due to chronic ischemia. They lead to the strictures, obstruction, compromised motility, gut motility, perforation, malabsorption, and fistulas. After surgery for recurrent or persistent anal cancer, one of the major post-operative complications is the perianal wound healing. A word about HIV positive. Here, the median age in those who are HIV positive is 2 decades early, compared to 60 years in non-HIV positive, it is around 40 years. They have increased risk of toxicity, particularly with perianal skin and anorectal mucosa. Two factors that predict a heightened acute normal tissue toxicity is the CD4 count less than 200 or any age-defining illness. A word about adenocarcinoma of anal cancers. Primary adenocarcinoma of anal cancer is rare. Anal cancer itself is rare, so adenocarcinoma subset is more rare. Prognosis of anal adenocarcinoma is worse than it is with either anal squamous cell carcinoma or distal rectal carcinoma. Retrospective series say that survival is better if we treat it akin to a rectal adenocarcinoma compared to treating it like a squamous cell carcinoma of the skin. Obviously, it is rare, so prospective studies are not available. Our national cancer database, a series of around 1,700 patients of anal adenocarcinoma, out of which thousands who underwent even surgery, did better fire were of 61% compared to those who only underwent CTRT, like a squamous cell carcinoma of anal cancer, where OS was only 40%. So OS was improved in this retrospective study if they were even subjected to surgery. Now, from a localized disease, let's come to an advanced metastatic anal cancer. What are the most common site of metastasis? As we saw, is because of the lymphatic drainage, it will initially go to periaortic node, liver, lungs, and skin are the most frequent site of metastasis. In the prospective trials, around 10% of the patients will present in the UK CCCR trial. 10% metastasize gradually. In ERTC trial, 17% metastasized, while in the AC2-2 trial, where maintenance was given, 22% of the patients metastasized at a later date. So around one-tenth of you to one-fifth of your patient will metastasize after initial CTRT. And upfront, around 5-8% patient of the patient will only present with a metastatic disease. The most widely published active regime for the treatment of metastatic disease is cisplatin-5-FU. Obviously, from the extrapolation of the benefit of 5-FU and cisplatin from the CTRT, in CTRT, this was only retrospectively used, but based on the retrospective experience, 5-FU and cisplatin was considered standard of care for many years. Response rate is around 60 to 65% of the patients. Then came a recently published trial where they randomized advanced metastatic patients. 91 patients were randomized to either paclitaxel chemo carboplatin arm versus the standard 5-FU and cisplatin arm. And they were the primary endpoint was to see overall response rate. The trial failed to show improvement in the primary response rate, which was same between the two arms, 59% versus 57%. However, the secondary endpoint, there was benefit in overall survival with paclitaxel carboplatin compared to cisplatin, 5-FU cisplatin. It was 20 months with paclicarbo versus 12.3 months versus with 5-FU cisplatin, and adverse events were less with paclicarbo. It was only seen in 30 serious adverse event was only seen in 36%, where it was seen in 2/3 of the patient with 5-FU cisplatin. So adverse events are rare. OS is better with weekly paclicarbo compared to 5-FU cisplatin. However, the primary endpoint failed. Here, the weekly paclicarbo is like it was 28-day cycle. Paclitaxel was given on day 1, day 8, day 15, and carboplatin AUC5 was given on every 28 days. Now, there is evidence that in HPV positive tumors, taxanes do better. So, can addition of 5 docetaxel to 5-FU and cisplatin do better compared to 5-FU cisplatin? So, this is a small phase 2 single arm prospective study where patients with unresectable or metastatic advanced squamous cell carcinoma with ECOG PS of 0 to 1. Total 66 patients were given either 6 cycles of 3 weekly standard DCF, especially in patients who were less than 75 years old and PS of 0, or 8 cycles of modified 2 weekly DCF. Around 36 patients received DCF and 30 patients received modified DCF. The primary endpoint was 12-month PFS, and it was around 47%. We saw in previous trial, it is 12 months total PFS, here 47. And overall total OS in previous trial, the total OS was 12 months versus 20 months. In this trial, 12 months PFS was around 47%. The overall response rate increased from 60% in previous retrospective and single arm prospective studies to 89% almost in the 3-weekly arm and 83% in the 2-weekly arm. In the subset of patients. And complete response rate is around 40%. With median PFS of around 11 months. So maybe triplet of DCF is better compared to 5-FU cisplatin. What about role of immunotherapy? As we saw yesterday by Dr. Susmita also in Grand Round that HPV positive cervical tumors, there is huge amount of inflammation. So immunotherapy has been tried in squamous cell carcinoma also in phase 2 studies, but in second line and beyond, nivolumab was given in 39 patients, but median PFS is only around 4.1 months. And median OS is around 11.5 months. another study of using pembrolizumab in 112 patients. Again, after more than one line of standard therapy, pembrolizumab was used. The overall response rate is only around 12%. Secondary endpoint PFS was only around 2 months. Duration of response, but those who respond, the duration of response has not been reached till the time of publication, and OS is around 11 months. I'm talking about second line here. Initially, we saw that OS was around 12 months in first line. And safety, approx 25% of the patient experience immune-mediated adverse events. So this is from my side. I will ask Dr. Rahul from radiotherapy to say a word about radiotherapy. And then we will take questions. We will like to specially thank Dr. Rahul because he came within 2 days short notice to us.
So hi guys, I think most of the anal canal you must have already covered. Just conceptually, it is fascinating journey of anal canal, treatment, because earlier it was surgery alone. And now we together as radiation and chemo, we are able to salvage 80% of the patients with, sphincter saving, and they don't need bags. So organ preservation ka another successful study, case study. And another way it is fascinating from science point of view is there was no randomized trial to achieve that. It was just a case reports or series that was first reported, and it was so intriguing for people to change the practice from that itself. Obviously, later on they refined and they did a better study, but that is how the real science starts in a clinic. When you have a good question, you collect good sincere data and put it out, and that stands for the validity of time. So I think from that aspect, it is a very nice thing to achieve. Now, another thing, if you would have examined anal canal patients, they are many times HIV positive, and they have a tumor which comes outside the anal canal and involves the skin, right? The perianal skin and all those areas. So whenever we give radiation to them, so first course of radiation is treating the whole pelvic lymphatics. So what you see on the first slide is a CT cut section of L5 S1 level. So that's the top level where we end our treatment, right? What you see in front of that, a light blue color shaded area, is the bladder top. So we try to fill bladder till there, so that maximum bowel is outside that area of the pelvis. So our bowel toxicity reduces, okay? And then what you see as a bag in front of it is the bowel that we have drawn to avoid that dose to that area. Because we have to treat the lymphatics which are behind, which are presacral lymphatics and the common iliac, lower common iliac. From that, what you see on the next slide, next picture on the right side, is what we're treating is common iliac, internal iliac, external iliac branches, as well as this presacral nodes. So these pictures, I'm just showing you that how conformally we try to put our high dose region to the area that we want to treat, and rest all is avoided. So what I'm showing you is 95% of the prescribed dose, right? Obviously lower dose will go through, but it won't be given throughout the area. Okay. So the major toxicity that you may suffer while giving chemo with us is hematological toxicity, because your most active part of the bone marrow is just behind the target volume. And we try to more, importantly, spare bowel and other things than the bone marrow most of the times. Mainly because we don't know exactly where is the bone marrow. And the active bone marrow is even more difficult to predict. Otherwise, we have to spare the whole bones. Kahin se to dose dalna padega hum logo ko bhi, hai na? So we have to weigh out what is more important than the other. So if we come lower down, this is more of external iliac, internal iliac, and then presacral lymphatics that we treat. The whole of the rectum is inside that. And then we come lower down even further. We go to the inguinals in the anterior part, and then the posterior part of the lower rectum and the anal canal. So these are the coronal and SAG images, just to give you idea how the volume is placed, right? So if you see whole of the anterior structure, if this bowel, this bladder was not so full, so then your bowel will be down here, and that will get much more dose. Now the urine is getting that dose. So that's the whole logic. You don't need technology for that. right? So those are the things that we try to do. So that is why patient, you need to understand this, because after chemo, patient needs to wait for half an hour or 45 minutes or 1 hour sometime to make this bladder full. And this concept is used in most pelvic tumors, whether it is cervix or whether it is rectum or whether it is prostate. All these cancers, we use the same logic of filling up the bladder, because then most of the dose is suffered by the urine. See, posterior wall of the bladder, we cannot spare. That will be in the volume, whatever technology we use, right? But anterior wall of the bladder, if it is crumbled, it will be all in the volume, right? Higher dose volume. It will come closer to the target. And the bowel also will come down. So this is a very simple technique where you don't need anything hi-fi. You can spare a lot of normal tissue, which will be a problem for both of us together later on after, you know, 20, 30 fractions, because everything will get swollen, whatever will get a higher dose, and they will be much more prone to infections. We'll get more cystitis, more, you know, bowel issues, cramps or diarrhea, other things. So it will stop the therapy in between. That's the main logic why I'm explaining this to you guys. Next is, this is what I wanted to show. So if you see that this is the surface or the skin surface part, which is usually involved. Okay, so anal canal may, and when we boost also, this part is given an extra boost after 2 weeks gap or something, because in original tumor also, it will get a lot of reactions. Just say oral cavity, head and neck may, you must have seen, no, under mukh and the reactions hote, aise yahan skin pe hote, and it is very painful. The head and neck cancer and the anal canal, these are the two cancers which are very painful because they have pain sensation over there where we are treating, and they get reactions in the pain sensitive area. So this is what I'm showing is if there's a gross node there. So it's very important for us to identify, because we can give a booster dose over there simultaneously with the rest of the organs getting normal usual dose. Okay. So what we are giving here is 57 gray and rest all is getting 45 gray only. And you can see how focal it is. So if somebody tells you that I'm boosting, you should not be scared that any extra dose is going anywhere else. Right. So even in the other immediately next volume is not getting a higher dose. Right. So this is a skin reaction that I want to show. This is grade 3 skin reaction. Whole of the skin is sloughed off. And this was a tumor which I was showing you in that volume also, right? So that tumor is also sloughing off. The reaction is basically because tumor is sloughing off. So we finished the 5-week course, but we don't want to stop in between. We try to give them maximum care at that time so that they have minimal travel distance. The buttocks don't rub with each other. They don't wash it too often. They keep it dry. Right? And Placentrex and other things may help them to keep it calm and moist, and the painkillers. So these are the major, you know, part of the care that we provide so that they finish the first course. Then we give them 2 to 3 weeks to heal. And then we give a booster dose to that primary tumor. That's all from my part.
Thank you. Thank you. So we will take up questions now. What's the frequency of assessment till CR? Frequency of, okay. So we first initial assessment is around 11 weeks, that is 3 months. And then again at 3 months, the 6 months would be 24 weeks. So we saw up to 26 weeks, there can be response rates available. Second question is from Lingraj. Is in maintenance trial of EORTCC, which drugs were used? Any data of CAPE maintenance after CTRT, especially in category of delayed response to CTRT? So in EORTC trial, we saw that there were two arms, 5-FU cisplatin and 5-FU mitomycin. So there is no randomized trial with capecitabine first of all. So there is no data of capecitabine. And adjuvant in this EORTC trial, we saw there is no value of adding adjuvant therapy. So there is no role of maintenance and no role of maintenance with capecitabine. What is the routine dose and field of RT? I will ask Dr. Rahul to take this question.
So routine dose, first phase that I said, no, we give generally 45 gray to the involved lymphatic area. That is what from lower common iliac, internal iliac and external iliac and inguinal lymph nodes and the primary tumor with the margins. So that is the phase one. If there is gross node, which is suspicious to be malignant or confirmed, like in inguinal area, we usually do a FNA to confirm it. Then we boost that also to 57 gray simultaneously in those 25 settings only. And this is the phase in which you give chemo also with us, right? In the second phase, when, you know, reactions have settled and patient is comfortable after 2 or 3 weeks, we give a booster dose to the primary tumor, which is in the anal canal. And that goes to 5 to 10 gray more.
So what I studied yesterday, 45 to 60 gray is to be given. Yeah, so more than total. 60 gray has no value. Yeah, this no is from yeah. my side.
That becomes less than 45 and 10 gray tak ka boost diya, to utna hi ho jata hai.
Risk of hematological toxicity during CTRT in sero positive versus versus negative. Sero positive have more toxicities compared to sero negative. It is only the subset analysis from the in prospective trials, the seropositive patients were not used. So it is only the retrospective data that we can see.
But yeah, cervix also same story. So they are more sensitive. So, you know, they will get more reactions also. They will heal better also.
Any relation to HPV in terms of response and prognosis? Yes, HPV 16 subgroup do better compared to HPV negative patients.
Yeah.
Any difference in management of geriatric patients, dose of RT or starting dose of chemotherapy? Is it safe to use mitomycin in geriatric patients? I have no answer to this because most of the patients are more than 60 years at diagnosis. So all on the randomized and the randomized trial that we saw, maybe most of the patients are geriatric subgroup only. Incidence and management of chronic radiation cystitis.
So with now the modern era, we are using IMRT and all stuff. The chronic radiation cystitis is not very common, but in case it happens, or it will happen in 5% or 3% of the patients for sure. The management remains same across the way we do it for cervix or rectal patients. And that is first is hydration, maintain good hydration, use, detect and treat the concomitant infection if there is. First is that. So most of the time, the infection or low hydration status chronically will precipitate a bleed. You know, so what we say is a river which is flowing is healthy, right? If the river is not flowing, there is stasis. There is, you know, more of acidic collection in the urine and all those concentrated urine. It will cause more irritation and will cause precipitate the bleed. Correct. So first is hydration, good, you know, flow of urine, as well as management of any infection which is there. Especially diabetic patients and all those patients will be of a higher risk. We see that very commonly in CA bladder, right? And then is about the three-way catheter. The clot evacuation is needed and all those things are happening, which is much more than if you have a focal bleed, you can do fulguration and all those things by cystoscopic evaluation. And the last resorts are surgical or hyperbaric oxygen and other things. So, you know, that is how we proceed towards it.
No role of imaging in follow-up. Need to follow up with clinically. Should not ask any imaging for resident. Yes, Ajay, I agree. So almost similar of anal cancer is like head and neck cancer only, where those patients with head and neck cancer are treated with CTRT. Almost the same. Only difference that I can find out, there was no significant benefit of adding cetuximab with concurrent RT. And in fact, adding cetuximab with concurrent RT had leads to increase in toxicity. Grade 4 toxicity were up to the tune of 25%. So adding cetuximab with CTRT in anal canal is not a standard of care. Otherwise, almost the management is like a head and neck, which is more common. So I'm giving you that analogy. Head and neck cancer, like patients of CTRT, treated with CTRT. Okay. Any other questions? I hope not. We will end class. Thank you, everyone.